go to Brendan then. I think Brendan wanted to present on something. So let me do that. I think that we're all squared away. So Curtis, thank you again, man. I'm going to jump right into Brendan's presentation. Here, Brendan, I'll spotlight you. And
oh no, no spotlight. No pressure.
Spotlight, you busted. You busted.
Okay. Busted for having interesting ideas.
That's right. Plant busted.
Well, I've given a few public talks before, but for some reason I've got like butterflies right now just because of the intensity sometimes around here. And dude, I know you guys are really smart scientists.
We're off the mellow scale today. So
yeah. I just disclaimer, I'm not a scientist. I'm not a practicing scientist. I'm not a mathematician or anything. I'm just call me a surveyor and a philosopher and just very interested in the progress of humanity. And I'm really interested in meeting aliens, like for real. So I'll start there. So let me share my screen. In that vein, I've done this little thing up and make sure I'm sharing my right. I don't want to make the same mistake as last time. Can you guys see this?
Yeah. Yep. Yeah, nope. It is good. And I'm recording. Cool, so cool. I think, yeah, we're all set, man.
Okay. Now, so in order to not have my headphones automatically go off, I'm going to undo my headphones. So I might not be able to hear you guys say anything. But this is, I've always wanted to meet an alien. I think like when I was a kid, I wasn't raised with Star Wars at first, but I was like about 10. And so of course, the first thing I do when I go and see that as a kid is afterward, I went to the library and ran a search for interstellar travel practical application. So I was like, how do we do this? And fortunately at the time, I don't know if, I think Al Cubierre had come out with his version of the warp drive already, but it wasn't super popular and there weren't a lot of people talking about it yet, or at least it wasn't in my library, and not having the internet at the time, that was my source. But the only real piece I found that treated it sort of seriously was a book on solar sails. So, you know, as some here may know, that doesn't really suffice that well. You'll see why. So, you know, we have forgive me if this is review for like most of you, but we have the challenges of interstellar travel. And for starters, space is big, like really, really, really big. Yeah. And how big is it? It's so big, we don't even bother measuring the distance itself. What do we measure instead? You know, light and time. We measure the amount of time it takes for light to get across the space at 186,000 miles per second. I believe that's 300,000 kilometers per second. You guys know all of this. I made this for kind of a broad spectrum audience because I feel like sometimes we get a little bit insulated into our little bubbles and speaking our lingo. And from outside perspectives, I try to share this stuff with my friends and family that are frankly normies, and they're like, what are you even talking about? So trying to normalize it here. At 4.36396 light years away, the closest star would take 4 years at that speed, and that speed's not an option conventionally because you can't get to light speed. Currently, the world's fastest rocket would take about 30,000 years to get there. So we need a better way. We have the conventional approaches, which pretty much amount to, minus present company included in some cases, the propulsion methods are generally ion or plasma propulsion through some sort of nuclear power, either fission or fusion. I mean, this can refer to the energy source or in some cases the actual propulsion, fusion or fission reaction, or solar sails, which are designed to catch a ride on a sunbeam or a laser, powerful lasers docked at home or on the moon or something like that. And generally speaking, these are both, you know, still impractical, still much faster than rockets, but still extremely slow. And generally speaking, we wouldn't see results from these for some time. And humans, as of right now, like a human, you couldn't put a human vessel on a solar sail. It's the surface area for the solar sail compared to the mass it can transport is huge. They're vastly different. And so you couldn't really think of that as a way to transport people. And ionic or plasma to do those distances, the amount of fuel you're talking about is obscene. And more the closer you get to light, you know, the closer you get to the speed of light, as some may know here. And then a few people have proposed exotic solutions, which are still within the realm of understanding and sort of conventional, which is antimatter and photon explosion propulsion, you know, and a big bell behind the craft, possibly some kind of pusher plate. And then I add as a caveat to the list here, the Orion project, if anybody knows about that, which is, you know, you designed a whole system to drop nuclear bombs behind the craft and, that would supposedly use up the, supply of nuclear bombs, on the planet and, or, you know, to defuse the situation, no pun intended. And, instead, as we know, they opted with chemical rockets. As some may not know, it's, you know, it happens that that system can deliver a nuclear payload. So they're like, hey, win-win. And as some may know, that, you know, NASA was, a lot of the beginning officials in NASA were brought over from Operation Paperclip. So a lot of crossover there. No shade. Might want to work there at some point, so I won't get political. These are still slow. You know, so you still have this problem of massive delays in time. So a few ways to deal with this: generation ships, human lifespans won't make the trip, breed. There's a few ethical concerns there. Like, how do you get a whole population of people that have left the planet and left all forms of government and adopted, basically been born into kind of a crappy situation? Like, you're all stuck in like sardines on a moving tin can to another, planet. So you have to have like an almost religious, you know, conviction to the cause. And, you know, as we know on Earth, that humans are very human and don't respond well to authority, for very long. And, so those are the issues there. Cryogenic freezing. You see this a lot in sci-fi, put them to sleep, and, genetic arcs, you know, print humans on the other side from raw material. I believe that Avi Loeb was talking about something like this in Extraterrestrial, in combination with the next stuff, which is robotic probes, send only automated machines, you know, which could make more machines for themselves, as we know with von Neumann probes, or, you know, possibly print out, be the ones that print out the humans or other, and or other life. Of course, like a few, you may notice a few of these on the list are nowhere near confirmed, but you still mention them here because they're closer to canon. So, you know, as you might know, none of them are very good, and a lot of them don't involve with any of us going and, or, you know, to meet the aliens and, or, getting there in our own lifetime. The best some of them do is maybe you'd have, signals sent from automated probes that basically have powerful AI that can manage to move around on the alien surface and do stuff mostly for themselves. And if any of them break, you're out of luck, right? And you don't get your pictures sent home. No ET phone home. Also, you know, here's a little caveat. Einstein's sitting there like the soup Nazi, except it's FTL Nazi. He says, no light speed for you. You can't reach or exceed light speed conventionally. We'll look at those other options. And because the relationship between speed of light, matter, and energy being very fixed in that E equals MT squared, you know, the faster you go, the more energy you have, therefore, the more the mass. I might be butchering that, but long story short, you just can't get there. There's no amount of fuel in the universe that could get you to that, to light speed, maybe some fraction of it, but then any acceleration past that, you know, you're just talking about more and more and more and more fuel that you have to add in. So, that's extremely impractical because, as we know, weight has a lot to do with space travel. Weight being less is a good thing. So we come to FTL solutions. We've got warp drives and wormholes, which are basically, you know, I think of those, these as two sides of the same coin because they both involve entanglement to some degree, and they're both a warp in the fabric of space-time. Just that, the warp drive, it moves fast, quote unquote, faster than light, but that's because it's moving space-time. And so that's how it gets around this, the light speed Nazi. I hope this doesn't get demonetized on YouTube for me saying the N-word too many times, that N-word. And then it has near instantaneous travel relative to a static reference point. Some examples of this would be the antimatter powered warp drive from Star Trek, and that's a fictional reference, and pretty much the only fictional reference I know of. It starts to become more realistic with the Alcubierre drive, which we talk about a lot. Well, that calls for a lot of exotic energy and basically a huge ring made of almost exclusively exotic energy. And that amount of energy somewhere close on the order of like universal levels. And so very impractical. But at least he gave us the theory and the equation and started us on this path. He's like, okay, it could exist theoretically in the mathematics of the universe. Not that it's practical, but kicks the can down the road. Then you have, you know, other examples like Sal Pais's FTL drive, Jack Sarfati's, both of which are theoretical, but both of which move the ball forward, right? Lower the energy requirements and get it within closer to the range of what we could theoretically do. And you imagine this process, it's no longer like a theoretical problem, it's an engineering on the other side of the coin, we have wormholes, which are theoretically plausible. We haven't seen one yet. We're working on that. And this is the idea that there's a hole in space-time, basically two points bridged between entangled points around black holes and other areas of extreme gravitation, extremely high energy. This involves instantaneous travel because the destination and origin are so entangled, they're basically the same place. They become the same, whatever way you want to look at it. This exists in fiction in a few different places like Stargate, Wrinkle in Time, which that has more to do with mental travel, but still technically a wormhole that they're using, basically kicking up an old wormhole. Another one I would say here is maybe Sliders, if anybody remembers that. But and I would put, I put here the Star Trek Spore Drive, which is that's in Star Trek Discovery. But how they're doing that is that they've discovered some sort of interdimensional or hyperdimensional mycelia network. Paul Stamets, was the namesake of the character on the show that invents this thing. We find this hyperdimensional mycelial network, and they're basically dialing through it like an internet. Finding locations of certain resonance in space-time and just engaging that and popping through. They use like a giant mutant tardigrade. Yeah, that's about right. To navigate through this system that's basically like a hyperdimensional extension of our local dimensional network of life. And that's just one of the most far out concepts I've ever heard of. I'm quite a fan of the Hellman. You'll see that like where I lean is a little bit more in those directions. And then we have at least one attempt to make this really, which is counterportation. I'm still working on understanding this, but basically it's using a quantum computer to draw up a theoretical model of a wormhole and the way that it transports qubits between two locations. They're using qubits to model an entangled photon between two locations, and thereby like doing this through quantum computers, they're able to possibly generate a wormhole between quantum computers and using that to model and possibly project entanglement with distant photons. Again, that is super complicated, but that's on the horizon. Pretty cool stuff going there. Here's a brief go through with the QBA drive. Utilizes space-time compression and expansion to enable faster-than-light travel. Its warp bubble bends space-time around it, removing it from the effects of inertia, so it gets over that light speed limit, and it travels in an envelope, basically. Theoretically operates within general relativity laws, but it requires this insane amount of negative energy or mass, which, you know, as far as we know, we haven't seen it, we haven't discovered it, we haven't created it in the lab. But there's more to come in terms of ways to negate the need for negative energy. So yeah, the energy requirement's insanely high. So we have Sal Pais, who is this, he's a pretty brilliant guy. And he wrote the super force paper, which is related, but he also put out these Navy patents that were the talk of the town on the internet for a bit, still are. People wondering if this was like, you know, a released patents for an actual working UFO, but no. There's debate over why he did this and why they released this way. Maybe just to say, hey, we at least know that something like a tic-tac could exist and maybe do these sorts of things based on what we know. You know, there's some factionalism in the Defense Department as far as some, you know, like the Air Force, for example, has demonstrated a pretty clear track record of trying to suppress a lot of stuff and using obfuscation and putting out, like, disputing the Roswell crash by putting out a fake story of Mogul that came years later. But I digress. It uses, it controls charged matter with vibration and spin for fusion containment, uses microwave emitters on pockets of xenon gas, convert that to asymmetric plasma. It's made to plasma, and then they make it asymmetrical through applying various frequencies, some of which might be terahertz frequencies, and that creates gravity waves, and those gravity waves are controlled through, you know, wave guide here. It achieves enough energy densities for space-time warpage or polarizing the vacuum if you're using Hal-Puthoff's framework. That propulsion pretty closely matches the observables for UFO phenomena by moving around so fast and violating, you know, a lot of what we know about inertia and physical movement in these objects we're seeing. So he emphasizes that his approach, he's very fond of saying, this isn't new physics, it's new engineering. So it's a new perspective on old physics. Jack Sarfati, who we know and love, he's offering to change the value of C in a vacuum by changing the electric permittivity and magnetic permeability, that exist epsilon and mu that exist in various metamaterials. So that allows him to engineer the space-time metric with a way lower power requirement, because in a sense that's like being front-loaded into the materials, or that your energy is in the material engineering to get those just right, your energy control, energy information, tension, to order these materials in such a way that they're so dense, or they such a crazy refractory index that it changes C. So that predicts redshifting from high gravity on the leading edge. So in front of the craft, there's gravity, which is pulling it forward, and that would create redshifting, observable in some cases, and blue shifting on the trailing edge, which is sort of, you know, some might call anti-gravity, or you could say negative gravity, or you could say negative space-time curvature, or negative energy, all AKs. So if you wanted to use the analogy of a black hole, front is a black hole, back is a white hole, or you that sort of thing. So red gravity, red equals gravity, positive curvature, space contraction, time expansion. Blue is anti-gravity, negative curvature, space expansion, time contraction. We have some other warp drive models. This guy named Notario came up with a way to lower the exotic matter and energy requirements by just simplifying the bubble geometry. So still we need some exotic matter possibly, but like less. And it's another tweak done to the math to bring it closer in. I know at least one of you guys in attendance, Todd, shout out here about your warp drive paper from Maxwell's equations, which I plugged into GPT at one point and wrote a different paper with in honor of this, because it seems very simple and intuitive, even though it's insanely complicated. They don't really fully understand it yet, but you did good there. And quantized inertia, which you talked to Mike McCullough at the last APEC. It's not, I don't think he's going around saying it's a warp drive. It's not technically a warp drive, but it's neutralizing inertia. It's possibly one way to play with inertia and or dampen inertia. And that's one way to allow for light speed travel, because you can get around the light speed guy, that the light speed cop. So you also have Yuri Oshenko, who wrote a paper about how to use a spherical warp bubble to escape a black hole. And you also have Casimir warp drive by Fernando Loop. And this one's interesting. Harold Sunny White, who has a fan base out there, he's talking about nanoscribing metamaterials in certain shapes that at a nanomolecular level foster Casimir cavities in a 3D printed material. And I saw a different paper that was talking about using AI to possibly generate these cavities. So if you're talking about an AI that's generating optimal Casimir creating nano cavities that it could possibly collectively warp space-time, that's pretty insane. You're basically talking about like the living conscious ships that are nano producing themselves. That's pretty major. And then you have Hal Putoff, who's done some work on creating a warp drive on his premise of polarizable vacuum. If space-time is actually a polarizable vacuum, then that means that you can polarize it. You can create gradients of energy on it that allow for you to warp space-time. And to an extent, I think that the Biefeld-Brown effect sort of does this. Maybe this helps go with that to help explain possibly what's going on when they have asymmetrical capacitance in those experiments. So when we get to wormholes, which are awesome, but here specifically I wanted to mention this ER equals EPR thing, which is so Einstein and Rosen in 1935 showed that two black holes at significant distance can be connected by a tunnel through space-time, a wormhole. But later on, Einstein, Podolsky and Rosen was... Yeah, so Susskind and Maldacena got together and made this new interpretation on wormholes, where they asserted that two entangled particles could be connected the same way and that those represent a wormhole as well. And that's over Einstein, Podolsky, and Rosen. That's called Einstein, Podolsky, Rosen. So the conjecture is the ER equals EPR conjecture. And it turns out that modeling wormholes turns out to be a super useful application for quantum computers. And that's a thing, believe it or not, is finding like, hey, we have these quantum computers now. What do we do with them? This sort of leads me to believe that possibly that complex nanocircuitry, either in conventional or quantum computers, entangled qubits and so forth, could and or the human mind could be entangled with micro wormholes. Maybe this is some sort of facet of reality that you know, maybe nature has been doing this since, you know, nature tends to be, it's been at the game longer. I'm not maybe intentional or not that we understand that there's a fabric to reality and that certain things exist. Then it's possible, or at least conceivable, that the oldest engineer we know of is already doing these things. And that leads to some other parts of this. Some truly odd solutions. Now, remember here, before I go into this part, you know, we're talking about, you know, solving a problem, and the problem being, how do we meet aliens? Okay, so not all of these might be, quote unquote, going to other planets, but they might just as easily involve meeting aliens. I wanted to bring up a quote from Einstein. He says, if I had an hour to solve a problem, I'd spend 55 minutes thinking about the problem and only 5 minutes thinking about solutions. So, you know, that's important, because a lot of the times when we're trying to fix something, we just start going about doing it or doing solutions, jump to solutions. Let's define the problem. A lot of us get into this kind of work or this kind of thinking and go and get physics degrees. Sometimes you go to other planets, but do you really want to go to a dead planet? I think a lot of people actually want to meet aliens. That's where the excitement comes from. Like, are we alone? You know? And so it leads to these other solutions. People talk about mental travel. You know, it's almost a naughty word in science circles, but, you know, talk about remote viewing, astral projection. But it has to be mentioned, because there's precedent for this in sci-fi too. You know, as this is going on, as Dune is really popular. So this would be transcendental meditation on steroids, basically assisted by entangled micro wormholes or possibly being engineered, and or altered states of consciousness, electron spin resonance changes generated in the molecular circuitry of the biological brain. We have, you know, these examples, the Dune Navigators, Wrinkle in Time. They're basically creating tesseracts, their brains, if you could call them brains, or minds is probably more accurate, since like some of them are literally stars incarnated human. And we, you know, astral projection, remote viewing, which aren't as far-fetched as you might think and have some at least tracking there in culture. So you have the idea of computer simulation, specifically like quantum enhanced computer simulations. You have, you know, we have Sora coming out soon. We have the ability to generate whole worlds through some combination of generative AI, quantum computation, possibly entangled photons, taking basically the information we get from distant worlds and what we know to run projected simulations on things. And is there a point, if quantum computers are going through the whole gambit, to possibly get some answers right, or pretty dang near to right, or spooky right? And how do we check that? And so we could possibly project super hyper realistic, perhaps accurate simulations of alien worlds, just as good as the real thing, given that depends on superposition as it goes through many worlds, and, you know, potential possibilities, which I think works a lot like the infinite improbability drive of Hitchhiker's Guide, which for some reason didn't make it into this. I don't know why. I forgot. But that goes through all potential probabilities, infinite improbabilities, and finds the right route. So these things could be helpful. And then you have entangled communication or projection. You know, if we were to unlock entangled communication, we may find, you know, it's like turning on an internet and basically sharing multidimensional broadband experiences. I wrote gravity boats here, but I misinterpreted, but Ray Chow, I'll bring up later. So is it possible that, you know, we see these ETs, we see UFOs, we see sometimes just entities, and there's all sorts of experiences like that. Is it possible that at least some of the beings we conjecture or believe are visiting the Earth are doing so using any of these mechanisms. Like, it might not be as far-fetched as we think. If a big wormhole is the same as a small wormhole, we could have billions of small wormholes in the brain, trillions even, on some level or another. And so we have altered states of mental travel. So Terence McKenna talked about the effect of a given psychedelic molecule such as DMT or psilocybin to his wording was a disc into a jukebox of the nanomolecular circuitry of the brain. I'm sure if that was possibly DNA, and that changes the electron spin resonance of what's going on in the brain. Pretty sure that's hyper speculation, but you know, it resonated with me a long time ago. And we have Jeremy Narby, who wrote this book called The Cosmic Serpent. That's about ayahuasca shamans. And one of the things that happened there was that they were able to, draw organelles from inside of a cell when they were able to do these sessions. And over the years and years of doing these sessions, they made all these paintings of their visualizations. And Narby gave a friend of his, who's a microbiologist, some of these pictures. So, this is a certain phase of mitosis or something. That's worth looking into. We have idealists like Bernardo Kastrup, Don Hoffman, Rupert Sheldrake, Chris Langan, Roger Penrose. I'm not sure if I'd call Roger a full blown idealist as much as the others. He's still respectable in some circles. And they all sort of more or less hypothesize that consciousness might be primary, at least closer to the fundamental laws of the universe than just an emergent property of complex computation of biological systems, aka the brain. I'm not sure if Penrose goes as far as this, but you know, they all are talking about something like that. This is a link to a really cool Stuart Hameroff presentation where he's going off about the work of Roger Penrose and others in this space. And he was mentioning that the microtubules and neurons act like light receptors. And in fact, one guy said something like perfect light receptors. And they possess some quantum properties, possibly even quantum entanglement with other parts of the brain, other microtubules to go faster than light within the brain. And that was related to Penrose's work. They might possess some quantum properties that have implications on the nature of consciousness, might even help solve the free energy principle. The free energy principle of consciousness, Carl Furston, might be something like that. Religion, you have some instances of something like this actually coming up in a lot of religions. In the Hebrew Bible, in the Torah, there's reference to rabbis doing this thing called kepitzat hadarek, which allowed them to transfer their mind, or they would say to project. You know, I believe that a few of them allegedly went and projected into the emperor's chamber, the emperor of Rome, which I believe might have been Nero at the time, and sort of harassed him as ghosts. Could be stories, but there's also reference to that in the Quran as well. They refer to it as Tay al-Ard, yeah. And that translates to something like earth underfoot, which seems to indicate there's a movement of the medium rather than the individual. And so there's some reference frame shifting, but that reminds me instantly of some sort of understanding of like a warp, as we talk about. Then there's references to Indian yogis over the course of history being able to project into multiple places, or remote view various places. We have reference to the CIA and parts of the DOD literally looking into remote viewing, as many may know, and they weren't, you know, it turns out it's not as crazy as they think. There's some instances of them being quite right. And so fictionally, we have reference, though, as I mentioned before, to Dune, which, you know, you have the navigators, the Bene Gesserit, Kwisatzhadrach, the one who can be places at once, which, you know, I'll bring your attention to how much this looks like this. Kefetzadrach, Kwisatzadrach is Frank Herbert trying to tell something, possibly. But I do know, I think that when I might need to double check and look this up, but I heard recently that Paul Stamets in his Relative Youth was working with Frank Herbert, the writer of Dune. You know, so full circle there, possibly. And you know, a lot of this is deeply subjective. That's the problem. At least when you're using mental travel, you know, remote viewing, it's kind of like in the UFO circles, it's like the equivalent of trust me, bro. And so there's got to be some way that we can, you know, use techniques, gather huge groups to intentionally do this together, double check their results in a double blind comparison later on and see, you know, if they can, we can get any objective verification and train that. Now we have brain computer interfaces. So like recently there was a mention of the paralyzed man that was able to use a computer. And that's a thing we have now. So there's the possibility on the horizon, just as easily as any of these other things, to record a remote viewing session directly and see, you know, whether or not it was accurate. We also have the emergence of simulations, and some might be like, I want to really go, you know, I want it to be real. And well, you know, what is that? Let's make sure we define what that is. And, you know, very soon we're going to be asking questions about more and more about what that is. So we have already have hyper-realistic 3D VR simulations. That's not hard. We already have generative AI visualizations, which is through, you know, the images, which I use a lot of. This is made in Midjourney. All these are made in Midjourney, by the way. All of my images. These powerful visualizations, which are capable of taking commands and generating hypothetical worlds, side by side comparisons of various versions of those worlds, which it may not be, but it sounds a whole lot like many worlds. So those going together, and we have a convergence with the ability to do hypothetical world branching, and that means you know, you could get a computer to go backward in time, in the sense that, like, we'll peel back the onion and go back, you know, 65 million years. One of the things you could do is like, okay, run a simulation of what would evolve, you know, if the asteroid that killed the dinosaurs never did that, and they were able, like the troodons are able to evolve into super complex humanoids, or, you know, go even further back, the Cambrian, and what if something different happened there? Any number of branching possibilities of the various ways that this planet Earth could evolve aliens. And it makes you wonder, actually, if, you know, some of the aliens we see are, you know, since they're humanoid, people say, oh, well, how could aliens from all these stars be humanoid? Humanoid happened here. You know, what if humanoid is a really handy, you know, body plan for other places, but also for here? And it might seem more likely that we might be seeing, if we're in a simulation, we might be seeing simulated visitors from other adjacent simulations, or if it's real, we might be able to see other, you know, visitors from alter Earths. And that might be something that aliens decide might be one of the answers for the Fermi paradox. They realize at a certain point they're going to find more versions of Earth that are closer to their biology and closer to their parameters, but still alien, close to home. And that's, you know, FTL is one of the byproducts of FTL might be backward time travel. So it would seem to make sense. And I think Dan Davis, if they throw him under the bus here, no, he's brilliant. But his multiverse slash warp drive talks about that. He leans heavy on the mini world side of things. That's possibly directly related to how you're going to get to somewhere else in this world. But I would say, like, you just as easily explore other Earths, still alien. this is all brought much closer to full circle with Neuralink and brain computer interfaces, which can, you know, they're possibly getting input and feedback in the system to make the generation, possibly even using part of your own brain to make the generations go faster, get closer to what you want to visualize in these simulations, and making them more realistic, so you could actually be there, maybe even inhabit the body of one of these aliens or something. You got it directly wired into the brainstem, and quantum computers. So they superposition the problem going through many worlds. And, you know, once we get these plugged into our generative AI and our VR systems, how much more likely is it that those results computations will be accurate compared to a classical computer's ability to do so? Then in addition to quantum computers being plugged into the AI, we have the possibility of new age analog computers, which run differently, I think, to get truly random data, and those are going to help out AI, as well as these dedicated language processors, which might be able to translate alien languages in real time into the actual impulses for your brain. So, you know, it might not even be quantum simulations, it might not even be classical simulations or quantum simulations. It could be black hole simulations. Like, if we get far enough into modifying gravity to produce our own micro wormholes or micro black holes, we might be able to run sims on those because of the necessity for info conservation, which is something Hawking talked about. That was the fact that because you need to conserve the information, possibly there's some sort of simulation coded, or the surface of a spinning black hole is coated with informational hair, which is necessary that could possibly, like a hard drive basically, is in terms of a bit, which is either vertical or horizontal. Those are kind of like the hair of a hard drive. These could code information and possibly code for an entire holographic civilization. That might be what we're living in, and or, you know, nest in a nested situation of black hole simulations. And in this case, with so many simulations running around and so many people running around between into out of simulations, who are the observers, and is it possible that different simulated/simulating worlds connect? Is there a point where you have, you know, all these quantum powered entangled simulations and nested dolls? You know, is there bleed through effects, like that we sometimes accidentally see the simulators in as these aliens, or vice versa? If we did it ourselves, is there some potential for connection as more than just a NPC to PC? Like, if you're playing something like The Sims, if you ever wonder, like, are they aware of what's going on here? Just like how we are, like, is this a simulation? You imagine the Sim characters are thinking the same thing. And that leads us to the question, inevitable question, what is reality in this context? Is this reality being simulated? Or if this reality can be simulated, what does that tell us about reality? And we have to ask these questions more and more as generative AI gets deeper into the rabbit hole of being able to produce video and mimic reality. And what does it say to us? It's similar to how these LLMs are now. I'm not saying they are conscious, but they have been brought about plenty of conversations as to if they are conscious. And that in and of itself says something. If we're so close to actually simulating reality, what does that tell us about reality? Is the basis of experience consciousness? So before we ask, is the base of space-time or the base of reality consciousness? We know that, you know, as far as we know, the basis of experience is consciousness. That is the hard problem of consciousness, why we need to deal with consciousness. We can't just leave it on the side because we all have an experience of being conscious. And we get to the possibly entangled internet of experience. Before I go down here, another sidetrack to this is the movie. I don't know if anybody's seen Fantastic Planet, where you have those giant blue aliens, and it turns out that their whole civilization is bent around meditation, which is using this advanced technology to take their souls and basically astrally project to this other planet up in the sky, up in this moon, basically to dance with other ETs that are doing the exact same thing to where they are. And that's like the goal of their civ. And the humans who survived a nuclear explosion, these little tiny people, messed that up by getting a hold of the rockets and going there and blowing up their dance. And that was like really deadly to them, because maybe at a certain point, that's how you thrive and survive and spread your informational seed throughout the galaxy, or galaxies, by doing these things. So with that in mind, there may be this sea of experiences and stuff all around us that are happening. We can't even really shake a stick at yet. So matter may be very hard to move across space-time, but data is easy. And, you know, it takes a lot of energy to open up a wormhole or a warp drive or a warp bubble for a big spaceship, but not that much energy to open up really tiny areas. And what is all of this except a bunch of really tiny areas? And entangled communication might not be possible yet, but might be soon. At least there's people looking into it. And, you know, we can see how simulations of wormholes are already happening in quantum computers to show that you know, somebody's working on entanglement there. So we have Ray Chow's gravity wave communications. These aren't entangled point to point themselves, but they're using entanglement basically to convert gravity waves to electromagnetic waves and vice versa. But this could be like lossless communication, because gravity waves, you know, may not interfere with matter. And so if you see Tim's talk with Raymond about this, there's a possibility for some kind of lossless communication across the planet without satellites. So you picture that over galactic distances. You have possibly some of the basis, still moving at light speed, but the basis of a high broadband communication system. We look at the counterportation from the previous examples with wormholes. And I recommend looking into that if any of you are curious and much more intelligent than me, I know, to look into that. And so we can imagine that there may be, are they just trading emails over long distances? Probably not. You know, they might be trading simulation packets or the code for their own algorithm to simulate their reality, to maybe not talk to each other directly, but talk to an AI facsimile of them in order to do hypotheticals, investigate hypothetical realities with all these others. I mean, we use the internet to game and trade virtual experiences with each other. It's not inconceivable, you know. If they're doing this, I don't think they're using IRQ. That's all I'm saying. Probably something much more broadband than that. Possibly with, you know, brain computer interfaces, neural integration, so it feels real. So the universe could be teeming with these kind of signals, carrying high resolution holographic experiences. You know, the holographic principle that there's possibly higher dimensional, more information coded onto a more liminal space, like the computer interface that we use is a holographic projection of ones and zeros that are living on the surface of a disk, and those are, you know, by coding between those experiences, by packing and unpacking algorithms, we get that Zoom and everything we know and love. But yeah, something like that. And we just haven't turned on yet. And is that, you know, a little aside here, is this sort of like what McKenna was getting at with what psychedelics more or less represent, that there's this a network and there's these mechanisms that exist throughout nature, possibly for humans to engage with this network that's far deeper and much more advanced than we could possibly shake a stick at. Although we might be getting to in our own crude limited as the internet, as we know it, is a facsimile or a crude representative model of the larger internet that exists in space-time and in nature. We might have the ability to generate something like that, and those may go together. That might be full circle, like why life exists, to generate AI, to generate computers so that they can generate realistic simulations that end up recontributing to this universal mental network mind. You know, I apologize for anybody that thought this was going to be a serious science talk. And so the other players in the game are just waiting for us to log on, more or less. Sort of like you have the board on one of your favorite online games if you play, and your friends are there and some friends are not, and they're all, you know, the ones that are on there are like, oh, hey, you know, you logged on finally. And there's our, you know, there's our aliens. Possibly we've been NPCs until this point. And the visitors we talk about might be some of these holographic avatars experiencing our world remotely or through levels of simulation, as we talked about, nested simulations. So, and that the next generation of internet, as we know, you know, maybe what if the next couple of generations of computers are, you know, these quantum-assisted AI computers with real-time visualization and brain-computer interfaces where, you know, they're either hypothetically or actually connecting to aliens on the other side of the galaxy based on your preferences. And like, you know, just like social media curates your friends that you might enjoy this or that person. You might enjoy this or that civilization. Have you tried the Gorgle opposites from Alpha Centauri and XL6? They're right up your alley. It's far out, but conceivable. And just look at the jump in broadband signal. As we get more computer processing and ability, we fill the gap. We find applications for it. Developers. And, you know, we get deeper experiences as a result. So I'm sorry if I've gone so long, but I think I'm done. And that, you know, we have this leapfrogging and capacity, and that's followed by a depth of computer experience, and that's then followed by another leapfrogging capacity. And that's it.
That's amazing.
Space Cowboys,
Brendan, that is amazing.
Listening.
Well, thank you. Thank you for that massive presentation. I'm doing them a little bit different too. I'm putting the slideshow side by side, so it may look a little bit different in it, like when it goes up on YouTube, but hopefully it'll be a little bit easier. So I'm going to put this on gallery view. Everybody put your hands together for Mr. Brendan McNamara. Brendan, that was tremendous. Thank you, man. Thank you.
Thanks for giving me the opportunity. I jitters the whole time.